Thank you, Madam President. Over the past 3 weeks, we have heard from the House managers and the President's counsel regarding the facts of the case against President Donald Trump. Much like trials in Lorain and Lima and Lordstown, Ohio, or in Marietta and Massillon and Marion, Ohio, we've seen the prosecution, in this case, the House managers, and the defense, in this case, the President's lawyers, present their cases. All 100 of us, every one of us, is a jury, or are the jury. We took an oath to be impartial jurors. We all took an oath to be impartial jurors, just like juries in Ohio and across America. But to some of my colleagues, that just appeared to be a joke. The great journalist Bill Moyers summed up the past 3 weeks. What we've just seen is the dictator of the Senate manipulating the impeachment process to save the demagogue in the White House, whose political party has become the gravedigger of democracy. Let me say that again. What we've just seen is the dictator of the Senate manipulating the impeachment process to save the demagogue in the White House, whose political party has become the gravedigger of democracy. Even before this trial began, Leader McConnell admitted out loud that he was coordinating the trial process with the White House. The leader of the Senate was coordinating with the White House on impeachment. I challenge him to show me one trial in my state of Ohio or his state of Kentucky where the jury coordinated with the defense lawyers. In a fair trial, the defense and prosecution would have been able to introduce evidence, to call witnesses, to listen to testimony. Every other impeachment procedure in the Senate for 250 years had witnesses. Some of them had dozens. We had zero. Leader McConnell rushed this trial through. He turned off cameras in this body so that the American public couldn't see the whole process. He restricted reporter access. We know reporters all roam the halls to talk to members of the House and Senate. He restricted access there. He twisted arms to make sure every Republican voted with him to block witnesses. He didn't get a couple of them, but he had enough to protect himself. The public already sees through it. This is a sham trial. I said from the beginning that I would keep an open mind. If there are witnesses who would exonerate the president, the American people need to hear from them. Over the course of this trial, we heard mounting, overwhelming evidence that President Trump did something that not even Richard Nixon ever did. He extorted a foreign leader. He fired a career foreign service officer for rooting out corruption. He put his own presidential campaign above our collective national security. The president said, this is just hearsay, but he and the Republican leader, together with 51 of 53 Republican senators, blocked every single potential witness we wanted to call. We knew there were witnesses. President says it was hearsay. We knew there were witnesses who were in the room with President Trump. We didn't get to hear from them. We didn't hear from Ambassador Bolton. We didn't hear from Interim Chief of Staff Mulvaney. We didn't hear from Secretary Pompeo. The Republican leader denied the American people the chance to hear all of them testify under oath. We've seen more information come to light each day, which builds on the pattern of facts laid out in great detail by the House managers. We've now heard tape recordings of the President of the United States telling associates to get rid of U.S. Ambassador Yovanovitch, a public servant who devoted her life to fighting corruption and promoting American ideals and foreign policy throughout her long, distinguished career at the State Department. With her removed from the post, it appears the president thought he would be able to compel our ally Ukraine to investigate President Trump's political opponent. Reporters have now revealed that Ambassador Bolton, again, Madam President, a firsthand witness, outlined the president did exactly what the impeachment articles allege. He withheld security assistance to an ally at war with Russia in exchange for a political favor. The Justice Department admits there are 24 emails showing the president's thinking on Ukraine assistance. But you know what? Senator McConnell down the hall won't allow us to see any of these 24 emails. Make no mistake, the full truth is going to come out. The presiding officer, my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, they're all going to be embarrassed because they covered this up. It wasn't just the president and the vice president and Secretary Pompeo and Chief of Staff Mulvaney. It was 51 Republican United States senators, including the presiding officer, who's a new member of this body, who covered up this evidence. It'll come out this week, it'll come out this month, this year, the year after that, for decades to come. And when the full truth comes out, we'll be judged by our children and grandchildren. Without additional witnesses, we must judge based on the facts presented. The House managers made a clear, compelling case. In the middle of a war with Russia, the president froze $400 million in security assistance to Ukraine. In he wanted an investigation into his 2020 political opponent. He refused a critical meeting with President Zelensky in the Oval Office. These actions don't promote our national security, the rule of law. They promote Donald Trump personally and his campaign. We know the president extorted President Zelensky. He asked the leader of a foreign government to help him. That's a definition of an abuse of power. That's why we have no choice but to convict this president of abusing his office. All of us know this. To acquit would set a clear, dangerous precedent. You abuse your office, it's okay. Congress will look the other way. This trial, this vote we're about to cast, they're about way more than just President Trump. They're about the future of democracy. It will send a message to this president or whomever we elect in November and to all future presidents. It will be heard around the world, our verdict, by our allies and enemies alike, especially the Russians. Are we going to roll out the welcome mat to our adversaries to interfere in our elections? Are we going to give a green light to the president of the United States to base our country's foreign policy not on our collective agreed on national security or that of our allies, like Ukraine, but on the president's personal political campaign? These are the issues at stake. If we don't hold this president accountable for abuse of office, if no one in his own party, if no one on this side of the aisle, no one has the backbone to stand up and say stop, there is no question it'll get worse. How do I know that? I've heard it from a number of my Republican colleagues. When privately they'll tell me, yes, we are concerned about what the president's going to do if he's exonerated. I was particularly appalled by the words of Mr. Dershowitz. He said if a president does something which he believes will help him get elected in the public interest, that can't be the quid pro quo that results in impeachment. Think about that for a moment. If the president thinks it's okay, he thinks it's going to help his election, and he thinks his election is in the public interest, then it's okay. The president can break any law, can funnel taxpayer money towards his reelection, can turn the arm of the state against his political enemies and not be held accountable. That's what this claim comes down to. Remember the words of Richard Nixon. When the president does it, that means it's not illegal. Our country rejected that argument during Watergate. We had a Republican Party with principle in those days, and senators with backbone, and they told that president to resign because nobody's above the state. Nobody's above the law. If we have a president that can turn the office of the presidency and the entire executive branch into his own political campaign operation, God help us. My colleagues think I'm exaggerating. We don't have the option to vote in favor of some arguments made during the trial and not others. Mr. Dershowitz's words will live forever in the historical record. If they're allowed to stand aside a not guilty verdict, make no mistake, they'll be used as precedent by future aspiring autocrats. In the words of House Manager Schiff, that way madness lies. I know some of my colleagues agree this sets a dangerous precedent. Some of you have admitted to me that you're troubled by the president's behavior. You know he's reckless. You know he lies. You know what he did was wrong. And I have heard Republican after Republican after Republican senator tell me that privately. If you acknowledge that, if you've said it to me, if you said it to your family, if you said it to your staff, if you just said it to yourself, I implore you, we have no choice but to vote to convict. What are my colleagues afraid of? I think about the word of Adam Schiff in this chamber on Tuesday. If you find that the House has proved its case and still vote to acquit, your name will be tied to his with a cord of steel and for all of history. Your name will be tied to his with a cord of steel and for all of history. So I ask my colleagues again, what are you afraid of? One of our American fundamental values, we have no kings, no nobility, no oligarchs, no matter how rich, no matter how powerful, no matter how much money you give to Mitch McConnell's super PAC, everyone can and should be held accountable. I hope my colleagues remember that. I hope they'll choose courage over fear. I hope they'll choose country over party. I hope they'll join me in holding this president accountable to the American people we all took an oath to serve. We know this. Americans are watching. They will not forget. I will close with quoting again Bill Moyers, the longtime journalist. What we've just seen is the dictator of the Senate manipulating the impeachment process to save the demagogue in the White House whose political party has become the grave digger of democracy. Madam President, I know my colleagues on the other side of the aisle know better. I hope they vote what they really know. Thank you, Madam President.